Bienvenue, chers collègues, à l'Université d'Ottawa. For those who don't know me, my name is Monica Gattinger, and I'm director of the University of Ottawa's Institute for Science, Society, and Policy. This is the first event of the new year for the Institute, and what an event it is. It gives us tremendous pleasure to host the inaugural lecture in the Canadian Science Policy Center's Policy Lecture Series. And talk about kicking off the series with a bang. Here we are, many of us, to hear Sir Peter Gluckman, the Chief Science Advisor to the Prime Minister of New Zealand, one of the most respected Chief Science Advisors in the world. I'm going to give a few remarks about the relevance of this talk for the Institute for Science, Society, and Policy in a moment. But for now, it is my great honor to welcome University of Ottawa President Jacques Frémont to the stage. Monsieur le recteur, il nous fait un énorme plaisir de vous accueillir aujourd'hui.
Merci, chers collègues. Merci, Monica. Chers collègues, distingués invités, permettez-moi tout d'abord de vous dire tout le plaisir que j'ai à vous accueillir ici à l'Université d'Ottawa, surtout pour celles et ceux qui ne sont pas de cette université. C'est un énorme plaisir que vous ayez bravé le froid pour venir à l'heure du déjeuner. This talk is so popular that I've seen scalpers selling tickets downstairs. We are especially pleased to host this inaugural lecture in the Canadian Science Policy Center, Science Policy Series. And what a distinguished speaker we have today with Sir Peter, and what an important topic which will be discussed. Sir Peter Gluckman is one of the world's most respected chief science advisors, and as attest by his chairmanship of the International Network of Government Science Advice. Welcome to the University of Ottawa, Sir Peter. We are very pleased to host this event, as it is so well aligned with the core strategic priorities and areas of strength of the University of Ottawa. Those of you who know me know what importance I bring to the internationalization and international engagement of our university. The public policy and the governance in the contemporary world is also a theme which is dear and very important to this university. And of course, research excellence in all the fields of knowledge. Needless to say that this event is particularly timely as the federal government sets about the development of its own chief science advisor's role. And we know how crucial that position is, can be, and I hope will be. This topic this week is especially important given what will happen on Friday morning south of the border with the swearing-in of that president. We have had in Canada until a year and a half ago, we've had a government which did not really believe in science or believed partly in science. And we've seen it has allowed us as a scientific community to realize the crucial importance of evidence-based policies, of evidence-based research, and of course, of evidence-based approaches to policy making. And in that respect, the future appointment of a chief science advisor to the Canadian government is certainly most welcomed by this university. The challenge of this coming, of the swearing-in of the new president in the United States is a challenge not only to the United States, but I would say to the whole world. It is especially a challenge to us universities because we rely every day on science, on facts, on evidence-based elements. And if we as universities cannot promote and make our utmost possible to put facts back into the center stage of policy making will be in a big difficulty. It is certainly one of our major roles for the years to come. So we are thrilled and honored to provide a podium for Sir Peter and look forward to his talk. But before that, je voudrais remercier l'Institut de recherche sur la science, la société et les politiques publiques d'avoir organisé notre rencontre de ce midi. Je devrais quitter en plein milieu de l'exposé. C'est pas par manque d'intérêt, au contraire, mais c'est pour parce que j'ai d'autres engagements. Thank you all for attending this meeting, and thank you again, Sir Peter, for being here.
Merci, Monsieur le Recteur. President Frémont is, of course, right that the timing of this lecture couldn't be better. As the federal government develops Canada's chief science advisor role and recruits a candidate to fulfill that position. The timing is also auspicious in that the stakes for science and for science advice couldn't be higher. In the context of post-truth politics, declining public trust in experts, in expertise, in evidence, and the scientific enterprise more generally, along with lower levels of tolerance for risk and uncertainty. In this context, some might question the relevance of science advice, even of science. And yet we need science more than ever. All forms of science, from the natural sciences and engineering to the social sciences, arts, and humanities, to grapple with the complex, interconnected, and fundamental challenges and opportunities before us in the world. Climate change, global health pandemics, genomics, terrorism, innovation, to name but a few. At the ISSP, we conduct research, teaching, and outreach on these topics. We have research projects underway in the area of risk and how to govern in contexts where expert perceptions of risk differ from those of the general public. Think public health, gene editing, energy. In addition, we're getting new research off the ground on innovation and how to strengthen public confidence, some would say social license, in the process and governance of innovation, science, and technology. And our flagship research project, Positive Energy, is feeding directly into current efforts in Canada to strengthen public confidence in energy decision making in the country. We are very eager to hear from Sir Gluckman today. But before that, it gives me great pleasure to welcome to the stage my colleague and friend, Dr. Mirdad Hariri, President and CEO of the Canadian Science Policy Centre, truly without whom none of this would have been possible. Mirdad.
Merci beaucoup, Monica. Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs. C'est avec grand plaisir que je voudrais annoncer le commencement de série de conférences sur les politiques de la science par le Centre politique des sciences canadiennes. This is a great pleasure to be here. In fact, we have been thinking about establishing the Science Policy Lecture Series for more than 2 years, but due to lack of resources, delayed until now. And the idea is to take the deep and stimulating conversation around the issues that intersect science and society and policy to various regions of the country with engaging of various stakeholders and stimulate that conversation and provide really a forum, an inclusive forum for everyone to participate. These lectures will be free and will be continuous across the country. And in fact, there is, I can't think of any other place better than ISSP for the inaugural session of this lecture series. I just want to sincerely thank Monica, the director of the center, and her colleagues at the center and the institute to be so helpful coordinating this very kindly with us and so proud to be here, in fact. And can be a better speaker than Sir Peter Gluckman for the inaugural session. of this lecture series. He has been really instrumental in stimulating and advancing the cause of science advice to government across the world in different corridors, in different places, by both reasons and the talks such as this, and especially his 10 commandment principles of the science advice to government, published in Nature about 2012, if I'm not mistaken, but also initiating a lot of work and projects, including INCSA. He was a key player in establishing that INCSA, the International Network of Science Advice to Government, who has been instrumental in promoting the idea and the discussions around science policy and science advice to government. Sir Peter Gluckman himself is a pediatrician by training and the biomedical scientist, and he is a distinguished professor at Auckland University. He's also science envoy and advisor to Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Trade. He's the chair of International Network of Government Science Advice, which operates under the aegis of International Science Council of Science. And he chairs at the APEC Chief Science Advisor and Equivalence Group, and is the coordinator of the Secretariat of Small Advanced Economies Initiatives. He has published over 700 scientific papers and several technical and popular science books. He received the highest scientific award, Rutherford Medal, and Civilian Award Order of New Zealand, which only 20 living persons have that, and which is the greatest honor in New Zealand, and numerous international awards. He's a fellow of Royal Society of London and a member of the Academy of Medicine USA and a fellow of Academy of Medical Sciences UK. Please join me in welcoming Sir Peter Gluckman.
Well, thank you very much. There's a number of friends in the room, and I'm glad to see all of you again. I apologise, I'm rather jet-lagged. I got in at about 2 o'clock this morning from New Zealand, so if I fall asleep in this lecture, I'm very sorry. And it does mean that I'll refer to my notes more than I traditionally do. I think most of us would accept this premise, that governments are more likely to make better decisions when they use well-developed evidence wisely. But not all is well in this nexus between science, broadly defined, society and governance. Science can be ignored, manipulated, or even falsely constructed for particular ends. The ability for misleading information to become the basis of political and advocacy and strategy is not new. I think it's been around for a long time. What's changed? So I don't think this is a crisis of knowledge or of expertise. What it is what's changed has been the nature, speed, and pervasiveness of communication. There's been little doubt that despite the many benefits of the digital revolution, these changed societal, that there have been major societal changes because of that revolution. And it's, I think, that revolution that's leading to this big shift in the relationships between citizens, media, elected representatives, interest groups, and experts. And of course, the genie's out of the bottle in that the digital world has a dynamic that appears largely beyond the control of traditional instruments of governance. And I'll return to that in a moment. And with the democratization of information, for all of its transparency and benefits, comes an increasingly widely held view that information alone is enough, that analysis and insight is no longer needed. And as a result, the populist tools of the social media in particular have served to call out the apparent elitism of experts, including, sparing no sector in that process, with science being no exception. So what theorists once called our post-trust society now appears to have taken a further step towards what's been called, rather trendily, the post-truth society, where knowledge is considered irrelevant in the face of personal beliefs. I'm not entirely comfortable with this term or with its generalizability, but it's become a shorthand which I cannot but help use, nor does everybody else. It's self-evident as I said before, that virtually every challenge a government faces has a scientific dimension. The issue becomes whether robust science is available and is well used, misused, manipulated, or ignored. So the issue is complex. On the one hand is the challenge, as I've just mentioned, of the populists, of populist politics in the media, and the tendency to equate experts with elites and then vilify them. And then parenthetically, I think we should be honest and think about the reasons why societal, economic, and cultural things have happened which have allowed this set of attitudes to be exposed. And on the other hand, the scientific community is not without beyond reproach. Science can get easily caught up in an elitist framing, particularly when we're arrogant, because we must admit that science cannot solve every problem, nor can we claim that it does, nor can we claim that we know better than politicians how to solve the problems of the world. We've seen many examples of scientists expressing considerable hubris and arrogance in trying to say they know what to do and ignoring the many other dimensions of addressing a problem, many complex problems, and going to return to this time and time again. And of course, science is not the only input into policy making. When I started in this role in 2009, I used to use the term evidence-based policy making. Sorry, that shouldn't say policy-based policy making. There's my jet lag at work. It should say evidence-based policy making. I don't like this term evidence-based policy making. The words are loaded and not helpful. I tend now to talk about policy making being informed by scientific evidence. Now, this may seem like a semantic difference, but I think it's really important. Evidence to the non-scientist means far much more than science. It might come from tradition, prior belief, particularly religious belief, anecdote and observation, which particularly for the politician are by far the biggest forms of evidence, whereas scientific evidence, we would argue, has a different basis, and that's what gives it any claim to privilege. But the assumption that then follows from scientists is that scientifically derived evidence capable and should it inform and determine policy? In reality, policy making and the science supporting it are far more complex than saying that the evidence shows that intervention A reduces outcome B and therefore the government must invest in intervention A. Let's parse this further. First, what is the evidence that intervention A works? Is it based on one trial or just on normative argument? Is it based in contexts that matter, or is it just because it works somewhere, it will work? Will it work here and with this population? Is it a scalable intervention? What's its effect size? What's the evidence compared to alternate strategies? What is the counterfactual? These are all scientific questions which the scientific community can give input to. But then there's a whole raft of additional non-scientific questions which are values-based, which need to be asked. What's the cost? What's the risks associated with intervention A? And who are those risks to? What are the trade-offs? Is B even a priority in the minds of the public or the politician? The point being obvious, that the decisions about whether to implement an intervention are not as simple as saying, I as a scientist know from one study that intervention A affects outcome B. This evidence-based policy language has echoes of Robin Merton's description of science when he said in 1942 that scientists stand apart from society and inform it. Hopefully we're well past that somewhat, religious view or priesthood view of science. As I say, I don't think we can ever claim that science makes policy, which is why I don't like the word evidence-based. I think what we say is science can inform policy, and we forget that at our peril. In this recent book by the Politics of Evidence-Based Policymaking, which despite its title is a great book, Paul Kearney makes an important insight. Scientists in general are very good at problem definition, but not so good at finding workable, scalable, and meaningful, at least in the political context, solutions. Be it climate change or obesity, this is a real challenge. Moving from the tightly controlled interventions that might be done in, say, a randomised controlled trial, to a real-world solution that will work in a complex context. And in part, it's because the kind of science that leads to problem definition is very different to the kind that's needed to respond. Problem definition often only involves a limited number of disciplines. Climate change definition only required climate scientists. But the solution involves behavioural scientists, economic scientists, many technologies, many other forms of science, and therefore engages a totally different range of stakeholders than those that tend to be involved in the definition. And that's what creates the complexity. There's been a growing interest in whether one can take the experience of evidence-based medicine and apply it to what's been called, and I don't want to call it that, evidence-based policy. I think this is a dangerous analogy, as Justin Parkhurst makes very clear in his recent book, The Politics of Evidence, in that, again, evidence-based medicine is based around particularly good in interventional science based on randomised controlled trials, but becomes much more limited in its applicability when you even go to preventative public health, where the situation becomes much more dynamic. And I think what we're seeing in evidence-based policymaking, in the areas like what works units and behavioural insights units, is that it's very good at dealing with narrow, specific, person-orientated interventions, but it's not very helpful when one's looking at the macro level. Equally, on the other hand, we're also seeing on the side a massive interest and increase in the use of big data and analytics and policy formation. Now, there's obviously enormous potential here, but there are many traps in establishing causality and many challenges to be worked through at every step in the policy process involving big data. And indeed, my office is currently preparing a report on exactly this topic. It's certainly not a question of promoting blind faith in data. It needs interpretive expertise. So even if we could simply wave the baton of science at the problem, there's then the issue of how and where to apply it in the policy process. Now, this is the common diagram you find in every textbook about a policy cycle. The only problem is it's a total mythology. Policy making never occurs like that. It's a much more complex, messy process, which I've tried to simplify up here. It's a very messy process involving multiple actors, coalitions of actors, both informal and formal, elected and non-elected. And the issue is where and how does science or scientific evidence fit into that process? Policymakers, like all of us, have limited bandwidth and often surprisingly limited manoeuvrability just simply because of the context in which they're operating. They often lurch to problems driven by the exigencies of external influences, the ballot box, media, emerging information, and so forth. To be sure, there are policies that emerge slowly over time and with deliberation and maybe somewhat closer to the idealised cycle. But these always get submerged by the acute events that arise. And the changed nature of the media cycle and the impact of social media is making that longer-term focus harder and harder for governments all around the world to cope with. Because of this, these factors, complete and established knowledge is never there at the time that policymakers need it. Instead, the available knowledge is generally incomplete and often ambiguous. Incomplete and ambiguous. Yet for the policymaker, decisions are urgent regardless of the state of knowledge. Policymakers live with uncertainty and ambiguity in every decision they make. In contrast, the science community often feels unable to go beyond the mantra of more research is needed. In other words, give me more money. We cannot, in the face of complex science, expect policymakers to be scientific referees or to translate directly from scientific language to action. And I could give you all sorts of stories of how I've had to take on a role in emergencies such as earthquakes of translating between the seismological community and the policy community, particularly about understanding absolute and relative risk. In other words, what I'm really saying is there needs to be an interface between the science community and the policy community, one that is involved in both translation and brokerage. Scientists, especially in the brokerage role, need to recognise that in a democracy, policymakers have the right to ignore, but hopefully not to deny, the evidence. Even if, in my view, it's unwise and ultimately counterproductive to do so. But the reasons they might ignore the evidence might involve many values-based considerations that scientific knowledge could inform but cannot resolve. Political ideology, electoral contracts, public opinion, fiscal consequences, diplomatic consequences, etc., etc., etc. The nature of democracy means that there are always multiple trade-offs in play in every decision a government makes, and different stakeholders have very different perspectives. So, is scientific advice of any value at all? If experts in a troubled post-trust and post-truth world are marginalised as elites, and if they can't solve our problems anyhow, do they have any value? In my opinion, scientific advice in this context is more important than ever. However, scientists, advisors, and advisory structures will need to have a particular sensitivity in how they provide advice and evidence in this context. They need to be sensitive to this complex entanglement of different players I've shown there on the left in that figure. And I think one of the things we need to recognise is the nature of this entanglement between science, policy and society is changing. And that's what I want to comment on next. So let's start with the changing nature of science in this interface. The first challenge is there's too much science. Last year, 3 million scientific papers of variable quality in 30,000 journals of very variable quality. What's driven this massive expansion? It's been driven by the expansion of tertiary education, which is a good thing, and the bibliometric disease, which has replaced proper performance assessment of scientists in many research institutions. Many of the papers produced have minimal impact beyond that on the author's CV. And somehow governments and policymakers have to work through that morass to separate the reliable from unreliable science. Issues of reproducibility, quality, and interpretation abound. Second, the nature of science itself has changed. Computational changes have changed the nature of the questions that can be asked and allow for a lot more non-linear analysis than, say, 50 years ago. The explosion of the life sciences is another factor. And between these things, we're seeing a much greater focus of science on systems, social, environmental, ecological and human systems than in the past. And of course, because of this, systems shift to a systems-like thinking. Science is now dealing with policy-relevant questions where the decisions are urgent, the values are in dispute, and there will always remain many scientific unknowns. This is the realm of what Rawitz and Futovitz called post-normal science, and it's where the knowledge brokerage between science and the policy community is most needed. It's in the ecological spaces, the environmental spaces, the human spaces, the social spaces, that the most complex issues of science and policy making occur. But this post-normal nature of science itself invites mischief and misuse, because it can be cherry-picked because of the inevitable invariability in scientific results. Scientific uncertainties can be inappropriately exploited, and these can be injected into complex societal debates. We've seen many values debates obscured by inappropriate co-option of science to be used to avoid debating the values debates. We've seen that in climate change, where there wasn't really a lot of debate over anthropogenic climate change for a long time, but there were awkward economic debates to be had. We're seeing it over the safety of genetically modified foods and so forth. And I think this issue of science being misused as a proxy for societal values-based debates is very bad. I think it shortchanges democracy. Fourthly, we cannot ignore the fact that there's been a far greater utilitarian positioning of science. That's why governments invested more and more in science, because they want something for their money. And they are the representative of the taxpayer, and I'll come back to the expectations that the taxpayer has on the science community as a result. Different stakeholders in science also have very different expectations and wants. NGOs, advocacy groups, philanthropy, philanthropic foundations, and of course the private sector are also major investors in science and technology alongside the public sector. Indeed, in some sectors, they have become the dominant funders. And these changes to the funding of science also create new tensions, and the real and perceived conflicts of interest must be addressed to maintain the integrity and credibility of science, and I think that's not easy when you consider this change funding arrangement. Some theorists of post-normal science, and I happen to agree with them, suggest that the concepts of knowledge co-design and co-production must now become inherent in the scientific process to better ensure that the science is done is trustworthy and in the interests of society. The debate within the scientific community that followed the recent publication of Dan Sarovitz's paper in The New Republic shows the many differences in opinion as to mission-led science, that is society-led science, if you turned it in other words, fosters or inhibits intellectual inquiry. This latter point is not metaphysical, because it has major implications for how the funding of research should be organised. And as we've seen, and I'm here to chair a review of CIHR, any shift in funding models inevitably leads to reaction within the scientific community. This is going to be a hard set of issues. And although there are these tensions within the scientific system itself, it's their impact on the interface with the rest of society that we should focus on. This relationship is evolving because, as a direct result of the world we now inhabit. And as I wrote about in this recent paper, which is on the web, the internet is obviously a double-edged sword. The manifest benefits to our network culture and economy are enormous. It's enabled a much expanded interface between science and society. However, it's also responsible for some of the most troubling trends at that interface. Increasingly, issues are being identified, from the loss of the authority of the nation state, as we're seeing in the debate over the taxation of the multinational platform companies, to the issues around the loss of personal privacy and autonomy, to impacts on social structures, who we network with, who we talk to, and how we talk to them, if we use our mouth at all, and perhaps even altered brain development. The interconnectivity of our world and the changed way individuals and institutions interact puts a lot of power and responsibility onto the digital platforms providers that increasingly operate beyond traditional jurisdictional control. And this has been accompanied by a general decline in the state and the objective role of the fourth estate, the conventional media. Increasingly, our news sources provide us with filtered information matched to our biases. Twitter has promoted the rise of ad hominem attack rather than a healthy debate of ideas, not to mention it becoming an echo chamber. We only hear views from people who already agree with our preceding biases. And to be sure, the internet has greatly increased the access to information, but that information is increasingly unmediated. And thus, both reliable and unreliable information can receive equal weighting, and erroneous information can come to dominate. And this has created an unprecedented platform for interest groups, some of which can be very sophisticated, yet promote very false ideas. And as we know, once projected, misleading information can become very difficult to erase. Misleading memes, such as the false link between autism and measles vaccination, become virtually impossible to eradicate. And we've seen how this kind of environment is impacting on the political process. In a sense, as I said at the beginning of this talk, there's nothing new in this. All said and done, the margarine industry, the dairy industry manipulated the truth about the margarine industry 150 years ago. We've seen how tobacco companies manipulated the situation over the last 50 or 60 years. All that's happened is become a much easier, much more overt, much more pervasive, and much more rapid. But to any information, people apply their inherent confirmation biases. And there's now considerable evidence to suggest that just pushing more knowledge at people does not change their minds. It actually drives a wedge further between those of divergent viewpoints. And this is one of the challenges for the science advisory mechanism. Central to all of this is the notion of risk. And as has already been said in the introduction to this session, risk has different meanings to different stakeholders. Scientists and actuaries may talk in quantitative terms, often with a pseudo-precision that masks large uncertainties. But to most people, in fact all people, assess risk through their personal prisms, the role, the various cognitive biases that affect how they perceive cost and benefit, and thus how they perceive risk. In turn, this means that the same data gets interpreted by different people in different ways, and that's why it is, and with it, you then add the echo chamber of the digital world on top of this, and you start to see how you just reinforce views by just pushing more information at people. Individuals have different ways and different values that determine how they see the world, each other, and the place within the world. Societies too have very different collective values, and most nations are now a much more complex heterogeneity of cultures and subcultures, which will influence the values culture within the society. How these risk groups perceive risk varies enormously and impacts on the political discourse. But of course, politicians have a different definition of risk to everybody else. It's called, will they have a job in 3 years' time? Recently, I'll just put this up here for a little bit of light relief, but this is in Colestis Juma's recent book on innovation, where he just highlights this point somewhat jokingly about how different societies perceive risk and precaution. And I see Canada gets a mention in this particular statement, but the point it makes is there are very different cultural views and societal views on these issues, and we as science advisors need to be sensitive to these issues. So how in this context can we enhance the uptake of scientifically developed knowledge into public policy? How can this be achieved given these challenges that I've talked about? The first step, I think, is to acknowledge the complex of this task and the very complex interaction between science and society, science and policy, policy and society. Yes, the cultures of policy making and science are distinct, the drivers are distinct, the goals and roles are distinct, but the interface between these two different cultures are so nuanced and so important that it's now unrealistic to see it left to just ad hoc interactions between policymakers and the scientific community. The post-truth dynamic makes this even more so, and appropriately skilled evidence brokers are needed at this interface. And given the complexity of this interface, multiple structures and multiple forms of brokerage will be needed. So what do I mean by brokerage? I distinguish it from advocacy because the point of brokerage is to be a translator and interpreter. Brokerage is about ensuring that the right and appropriate questions asked and answered to the extent possible. It's about what the science can tell us, what we can be reasonably certain about, what are the gaps in our knowledge, and what are the implications of what we know and what we don't know. What Heather Douglas talks about is the inferential gap. It's about the caveats that might be placed on our knowledge synthesis. It's about the policy options that then emerge and the scientific implications of each. It can highlight the spillover costs and benefits of each option. It can indicate the policy implications of each, but it cannot resolve those. It's for the policymaker to resolve between the options. The goal of brokerage is to enable more effective decision-making, but not to make the decisions. Now, there's no unitary model of effective brokerage. It has multiple dimensions. It must be able to deal with the instant input in emergency on one hand, and assist with horizon scanning and technology assessment on the other. It must be able to arise above the cacophony of competing claims and social media trends. And as will be obvious from the way I frame this talk, it's not just about talking between the science community and the policy community, but also is intimately dependent on effective science-societal interactions. Now, I think there's a growing consensus that two basic kinds of brokerage are definitely needed. First is there needs to be those who are close enough to the executive branch who can have that informal and repeated input at multiple points within the policy process. These individuals or structures can show where science can help and can act as interpreters when needed. They are conduits when needed between the science community and the policy community, and can look to where the integrity of scientific input needs to be protected and protected and protected. And this is the primary role of science advisors or advisory mechanisms, either in ministries or reporting to the Prime Minister or President. And importantly, the success of these roles depends entirely on maintaining the trust and respect of the executive, the policy community, the public and the scientific community simultaneously. The executive, the policy community, the public and the scientific community simultaneously. That's not an easy ask. It's not an easy job, and it requires a particular form of professionalism to achieve it. The second kind of brokerage, of a more technical and more deliberative nature, comes from the broader academy, either through expert committees or the National Academy or professional organisations. The principles of academic integrity and independence must protect the deliberations of such groups, but they are limited in what they can achieve because they're external to the process. They can probably only interact at one point. They can't ensure the integrity of their viewpoint is held through the process. And to increase their potential impact on the policy development, academies must learn how to meet the need of the policy community in structuring their work, in orientating their work, and thinking about how they present it. Too often, I think academy reports are there to show off the academy and their independence and their intellectual depth, rather than to address the issues and the questions that might be relevant to the policymaker. And part of the problem is they tend to come in, they come to be late into the policy process. And that's why I think having a closer relationship between those who are internal to the system, like science advisors, and the academies or their equivalent is so important. So, for instance, in New Zealand, I have the president of the Royal Society of New Zealand come to my meeting of science advisors every month so they can hear and learn where the issues lie. Scientists within ministries and agencies also have critical, important roles, and I know this has been a major issue in Canada. Meeting the need for appropriate and more transparent protocols for the access to their knowledge by the public is an ongoing challenge, and there are complicated constitutional issues around this, and they vary across countries. But I think around the world we need to work harder so that that body of knowledge is more accessible in appropriate ways in the process. The goal, whether you're internal or external to the system, must be to show where science can help to ensure that the appropriate and justifiable questions are answered, to separate good science from bad, to distill the overwhelming amount of information, and to interpret confusing claims without alienating the audience, and to protect trust in the system, in the scientific system and its processes. The issue is how can we recast this perception of the expert not as an authoritarian elite, which is what Merton described it as in 1942, into a knowledgeable, but into something which is more democratically appropriate, namely as a knowledgeable voice with something valuable to contribute, but not to claim we know everything. The third factor is broadening the understanding of scientists. As scientists, we've been trained largely in 20th century models of universities, and most of us are ill-equipped to deal with the 21st century demands. So we must learn to be more practical, but more proactive, and understanding issues of policy relevance, to use the tools of modern communication better, and to do so with a particular responsibility which many scientists, particularly when acting as individuals, don't think about. In my view, all professional scientists, and we could debate the word professional, need a more critical understanding of the place of science in society. They need a solid grounding in some concepts of science technology studies, and they need to understand the context of the application of their work, and not as a minor add-on, but as a fundamental part of how they undertake scientific practice. And I think this has profound implications for doctoral and postdoctoral training. I think having scientists trained in these narrow disciplines of molecular biology or physics, as opposed to in this broader context where science fits into society, is critical to address. And I think universities around the world need to think about this with urgency. There are some great examples of emerging scientists who can be both outstanding scientists and be deeply interested in this interface with policy, and who are seamlessly intertwining science, rigorous science, with an interest in the policy space. For interest, members of the youth academies, such as the Global Youth Academy, I see Reese is here, Carstens is here, and structures such as the Science Policy Exchange in Montreal, Paul Dufour is here, are the kind of structures that demonstrate how scientists can have one foot in the policy world without losing credibility as scientists. I think another factor, just parenthetically, which I'll just mention, is the role of the science media centres. I think the science media centres in those countries which have them have been a great resource to better equip scientists to dampen the flames of post-truthism, and I would like to see them expanded more globally. A fourth step, which I've mentioned already, is pointed to in the work of scholars such as Rawitz, Funtowicz and Jasanoff, who highlight the importance of co-design and co-production in building trust between the science community and society. These words have an evolving meaning, but they highlight the need for greater transparency within the processes of science. True engagement will be hard and challenging. What does it mean to involve non-scientists in peer review and science governance? And I think this will lead to fundamental shifts, much greater fundamental shifts in the structure of the scientific apparatus than most scientists recognise at the present time. A final step, or a fifth step, which some have erroneously seen as an issue of societal deficit and therefore as being the only necessary step, and it's far more complex than that, is to improve general scientific literacy and critical thinking. Among the most promising approaches here is, I think, citizen science. Done well, it's neither the exploitation of free data or free labour or action-orientated research. Instead, it occupies a space in which can engage citizens on questions relevant to them, while also imparting a scientist's inherent scepticism and meticulousness of process. And some early evidence suggests it's an understanding of the processes of science that becomes the best defence against post-truthism, rather than trying to treat it as a knowledge deficit. The strategies I've outlined here are diverse in their approach and in the audiences, but they share a common goal: developing and maintaining trust in scientifically derived knowledge. Simplistically, effective knowledge brokerage requires different dimensions of trust. The four different dimensions of trust I've already alluded to, but bear repeating and repeating and repeating: maintaining the trust of the politician, maintaining the trust of the policy community, maintaining the trust of the public through the media, and maintaining the trust of the scientific community. Maintaining this equilibrium is not easy, and that's what necessitates an ecosystem of brokers. Those internal to the system, those external to the system, those more involved in the informal discourse with the policy and the political community, those more involved in more deliberative discourse and advice. Finally, as has been mentioned, I chair the International Network of Government Science Advice. And we've been working with ICSU, UNESCO and the World Science Forum towards developing a set of operating principles and guidelines that might help in this regard. This is being led by James Wilson and Dan Sarovitz, and it's ongoing, but I particularly acknowledge Mark Sana, who's somewhere in the audience, who's playing a major role in this work as well. Any underlying principles must relate ultimately to these issues of integrity advice, trustworthiness, and maintaining this principle of brokerage rather than advocacy. Done well, inclusively, and across national boundaries, scientific advice can hopefully play a productive and constructive role in an increasingly complex, troubled, and changing world. It is a voice of, I think, well-reflected knowledge that is critical in every part of government. And despite the difficulties, I think if we use the approaches I've talked about here, we can resist some of the silliness that's developing at the present time. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, Sir Gluckman, for this very insightful speech.
I want to zoom in on one comment you made. You made the comment that the academy sometimes struggle to show their competence, their independence, and then at the same time being helpful. So I'm just curious if you see a tension in general between being truly helpful and being truly independent.
Hello, I just wanted to ask, with the creation of the Chief Science Advisor position in Canada, you emphasized a lot of the idea of creating this trust and building trust, particularly with a number of different stakeholder groups. How would you advise them to build that trust relationship with the public?
Well, I think to answer the second question first, because Mark's question is actually a very complex question, trust, I think, depends on not being arrogant. I think that's the first thing. I think the more that we show that science is part of the story, but we've got to be cognizant of all those other domains that the politicians need to consider, but the public are also considering all the time, their own perceptions of situation. I think the public has got sick and cynical about claims that we've cured cancer for the 57th time, that if you just do this, obesity will be addressed, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I think the public is much wiser than that. I think so. I think trust depends very much on the way the science advisor speaks. So, for example, take genetic modification, genetically modified foods, a particularly contentious issue in my country. I was pleased when, at a meeting recently, one of the great commentators on science, Roger Pilker, pointed out, I've been listening to Peter Gluckman for 5 years, and I still don't know what he actually thinks about genetically modified foods. Because my point is, I can advise what the science is around the safety of GM foods, not quite open, there's no evidence that they're not safe, but that just because I say they're safe doesn't mean that's what the government should do, is by promoting the growing of genetically modified crops. That's a whole set of other decisions which is for the public and the government on behalf of the public to make, how their perception is of the big food industry, how the perception is of interfering with nature, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, I'm just using that as a microcosm of the point that if I avoid demonstrating hubris, that I know the answer, I know the science, and I'm also not afraid to say I don't know, and how many scientists are afraid to say I don't know, and I also avoid, when I'm talking to anybody, more research is needed. There's always more money research needed. But if the second I conflate the discussion over the science, which is needed for decision making, with an argument for I'm really lobbying for more money for science, and we definitely need more money for science in New Zealand, I lose that trust. So it's all about understanding what, as a broker, you're there to do and not exceeding that role by becoming an advocate. Individual scientists can be advocates. All scientists are advocates for their areas. My area of science is the most important. It should have funding increased 57 times. That's not the point. It's what I am doing, and I'm trying to show the government, I am trying to show everybody I am not the government in drag. I'm not trying to argue I know better than the Prime Minister. I'm trying to show, and it's just, that is a really important part of the story. In terms of Mark's question, let's be honest, there's no complete independence. The science community is funded ultimately by the taxpayer. Ultimately, and it's not doing it just to be a public good, it's doing it because that knowledge is ultimately of value to society in some ways. So I think the point about independence is not that you're entirely independent of society, that's the whole point of the post-normal paradigm. I think the point is more that you're using an independence and sets of processes to acknowledge those biases and where those biases come from and manage them appropriately. But to go to that philosophical independence, complete independence, it's just not possible to do it. And so I think just like virtually all science is funded by somebody, and all scientists want to get refunded. So you end up in this situation, it's the processes you use, the peer review. All my reports, if they're a formal report, are independently peer-reviewed. And that's not everything I write, obviously. That's to do with what I'm talking about. If I'm asked to give a deliberative report on something, that's peer-reviewed. It's the processes you use. And for the academies, of course, they have very good processes for demonstrating that independence of thought. It's independence of thought that you're really interested in, not independence of structure.
One question from each microphone. Margaret, you go ahead.
Margaret McQuaig Johnston of ISSP. And the real crux of big public policy decisions happen at the cabinet table. And what the cabinet ministers see and read and prepare for those public policy decisions is in the cabinet paper system. It's in the requirement for what is included in that, not a 100-page document, but, you know, 10 to 30 pages, including annexes. And there's always a struggle in the central agencies as to what are the requirements for the memoranda to cabinet. Is there a section on environmental impact? Is there something on federal-provincial relations? What's the evidence and the science behind the public policy options? I wonder if you can tell us a bit about, from your own experience, what's important in how science and evidence is included. And it's critical not just for the day that cabinet is making the decision, but what goes into those documents is negotiated in advance through interdepartmental meetings, discussions with central agencies, and so on.
That's a sufficiently important question. I'd like to answer that question now. That, of course, is why you need people in terms of the system. That's why you have departmental science advisors in the UK or New Zealand system. It's why you have a chief science advisor who probably who might get a look. The important point you made is you need people in the system from the first brainstorming about policy situations. You can say, science can help you here. Would you like a report here? Would you like that there? The science advisors, and we have science advisors now in the 9 major departments of government. They act as a committee, they report. I chair it. It also has the chief economist and the chief statistician as members of that group, plus a senior member of the civil service. It works in 2 major clusters now, a cluster around the social sector and a cluster around the natural resource sector, and I think soon a cluster around infrastructure. And an awful lot of cross-departmental discussion happens in those places. And, of course, there are the people who can say and scream and yell if they think the science is being misinterpreted into the policy papers. Now, the British Cabinet Manual some years ago experimented with a line within the Cabinet paper that said, is this in accord with the evidence, and if not, explain why not. That failed rather rapidly as an approach. But we've had a couple of episodes, which I won't detail because here, where the ministers have asked that the scientific advice be specific and identified as within the cabinet paper or attached to the cabinet paper. And our new Prime Minister English, is actually very strong about this. So I imagine that over time, particularly in the more contentious areas, we'll see an increasing number of examples of where science advice is attached to the cabinet paper as a 1-paragraph summary or something like that and kept separate. The other situation which is emerging, and again, I have to be careful because we have a new government, is a couple of areas the ministers will sit down directly with the science advisors, with or without officials, for a chat and explore the issues directly on particularly contentious issues.
That's pretty cool. Thank you very much.
It's a whole lot of informality. And my point is that's why you need science advisors, because that's not going to be done by an academy from the outside. They're not going to have that access. The number of times, and again, that a senior member of the Cabinet Office, the Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet, said, Peter, would you look at this cabinet paper? We're not comfortable with it. Do you have a view on it? Mm. It happens every week. Doesn't say I can do much, but at least I can at least give them input of what I think is the problem.
Ezra Miller, and I'm a consultant to the federal government on science and technology issues. I have a question related to the training of scientists. And that is, very often they can go through their entire training without any background in the social sciences. And I'm thinking how useful it might be when a scientist finds him or herself in a policy-related position to have some economic background related to such concepts as cost-benefit, shadow pricing, social cost, life cycle cost, things like that. Do you think there's a need for that?
Yes. I mean, what we've done, what I'm doing at the moment in New Zealand, because I'm actually advocating that our universities need to think at the master's level at least of some coursework for those in science, but I haven't won that battle yet. Universities are the most conservative organisations on the planet, in my experience, is we've set up our version of the Canadian Science Policy Exchange, but differently, 30 in Auckland, 30 in Wellington, who actually are a mixture of scientists and policymakers at a young stage in their career, more as a training experience rather than actually, that's its primary role, but actually also to give input into my office from a younger generation.
Thank you.
My name is Peter McKinnon. I'm associated with our Faculty of Engineering and the Telfer Business School here at the University of Ottawa. Thank you for a very interesting presentation, Sir Peter.
I'm sorry I was a bit tired and read too much.
Well, I have a question related to your sort of your evidence. It struck me that much of what you were talking about was kind of the evidence coming from Western-style governments and institutions. I'm just wondering if you have an opinion about sort of a bicameral view of the rise of science and technology in China, India, Japan, and much of Asia, in fact, where some of these social issues you stressed don't seem to be as prevalent there.
Well, I'm not so sure. I actually direct a laboratory in Singapore still, and I can tell you that I think many of these issues apply there. I think the cultural Western view of those cultures sometimes underhides what's actually going on there, and because that presents differently. But when I talk to my Chinese, my Japanese colleagues, my Indonesian, my Thai colleagues, these same sets of issues apply. They have a different place because they're in a different state of economic development, some of them. But I don't think you would find going to China any less concern over many of the same sorts of issues. The dynamic in the post-truth world may not be the same yet, but it's emerging, certainly in Singapore.
Well, I do write about science and technology in China, and I've lived there, and I haven't found that experience to the same level as you've described. It could be a timing issue, but thank you very much.
Okay, I don't agree. But Daryl, hi.
Hi, Peter. Daryl Copeland. I'm a former Canadian diplomat and lately have been writing and teaching a lot about international science and technology and science diplomacy. Peter, the topic of your address today, science advice in a troubled world, I'm thinking about the troubled world part and reflecting on the fact that so many of the issues that people in foreign ministries are dealing with have in common a major S&T dimension. So whether it's climate or biodiversity or weapons of mass destruction or non-proliferation or what have you, the huge science and technological content in it, and these are very non-traditional issues for people with a background in diplomacy and international relations to be grappling with, tend to be more comfortable with territorial disputes and ideological competition and international treaty law and so on. So about the need for science advice in foreign ministries and your role doing that in New Zealand, could you offer us some insight on the difference between offering that kind of advice to people in central agencies like prime ministers or presidents and people that work in foreign ministries and indeed the foreign ministers themselves? Have you come across any kind of fundamental distinction in those two functions?
Well, I think in general, if we can separate that question into two parts, I think there's a generality that clearly when you go from a working for the whole of government at the level of prime minister or president to work for a ministry, by definition, you're getting to more specific issues. I mean, most policy issues actually sit within a ministry or a cluster of ministries rather than with the prime minister. And therefore, departmental science advisory mechanisms become very important. And if I looked at what my departmental science advisors are doing, they tend to be more the ones doing the more technical reports on water quality or whatever than the kind of broad-brushed advice I am giving. When it comes to foreign ministries, I think the problem's been the framing. I think the traditional language of science diplomacy has not been utilitarian enough for the foreign ministry to understand what it means. Therefore, you know, if you talk about the science for diplomacy, science in diplomacy, diplomacy for science, you, as you know, the average foreign ministry guy, the eyes will glaze over. It doesn't actually mean anything for them. So what I've been working on is a more utilitarian framing
of
science diplomacy so that it actually meets their needs. And if you think about it, it's very simple. The science that foreign ministries need to deal with national interest, be it security, be it economic growth, a relationship that they need to manage or build, the science they need for cross-boundary issues, resources across boundaries, conservation issues across boundaries, et cetera, and the science for the global interest, which is SDGs, climate change, so forth, where the ultimate, the UN system is heavily involved. And if you think about it, there's a real set of issues around science advice at that level, but I don't have time to go into it now. And the second I turn it to that framing, national interest, common interest, cross-boundary interest, global interest, the diplomats start to see where they can use science to their advantage. So what I'm writing about now is a more utilitarian framing of science advice. And as you may know, Vaughan and I recently ran a course in Vienna for 22 foreign ministries, not for scientists, but for the diplomats, on the role of science within foreign ministries. Mm-hmm. And again, it's Vaughan and I are currently writing up some of the stuff at the present time.
First and foremost, by thanking the Canadian Science Policy Centre for seeing fit to host the first lecture here at the University of Ottawa with the Institute for Science, Society and Policy. It has given us great honour and we're so very pleased. Thank you, Mirdad. Thanks to the staff at the ISSP for pulling this together. And last but certainly not least, thank you to Sir Gluckman for an absolutely outstanding talk that not only laid out the definition of the problem, but a real roadmap for how we should go about addressing it. I'd like to invite all of you to join me in thanking Sir Gluckman.